And whether or not you're meeting for the first time at this moment, or you were in class together 5 years ago or 20 years ago, there is such a thing as a TC person. Right? So let's hear it. What is a TC person? Thoughts in the room?
Encouraging.
Awesome. Encouraging.
Ambitious.
Ambitious.
Curious.
Friendly.
Collaborative.
Fearless.
Innovative. Visionary. How about given to the greater good? Service. High service. You are TC people. And it's in that spirit that I share with you some work that together with my team we have done over the past nearly 20 years now. Spirituality in the two first decades of life has been shown by science to be foundational to our nature. We are born spiritual. And in fact, it appears as we look across medical and social sciences that we function optimally when spiritual development is at the hub of all other lines of development. I'm going to take you through a bit of a journey on the science surrounding spirituality in development, starting with the voices of teens speaking in their own language in the first person of their own spiritual relationship, their own personal transcendent connection to the world.
Best and brightest kids who had a lot to say about belief.
So how's that for a TC moment?
Yes.
TC moment. TC. Okay. Innovative, sitting in your chair, you, sitting next to you on the left and the right, innovative, about service, and passionate about your journey. A TC moment. I don't know if this work could have grown up anywhere in the whole world other than TC. And it has been with steadfast encouragement that TC has stood behind our work, our lab, and our translation of this very cutting-edge science into practice, foremost for the people who have the least. And it has really been a partnership that I share with you between us and TC. So about 15 years ago, I started on this research journey and have found each year more and more students coming to study spirituality from the view of science, practice, and integration into educational spaces, community spaces. We're in some of the public schools, we're in some of the, we're in Covenant House, a homeless shelter. We find this work to be very welcomed by people on the front lines, who already, before they even look at the science, often express knowing in their heart that spirituality is indeed the lead foot through which children transform, through which children find bearing, through which they establish confidence, a sense of being in the larger sacred universe. And so our science, in a sense, restates that which people on the front lines know. And yet there are moments where people of service, and oftentimes even people of faith traditions, say it is such a delight to see what I've known in my heart mirrored through science. And in fact, there are ripples of insight in the science which can direct my own spiritual life. There are ripples of insight in the science that can direct my own service, my faith-based service, or my secular service from a spiritual perspective. So science and spirituality go hand in hand. When I was in Houston speaking for a large interfaith community, the priest came up with tears in his eyes and said, what I've always known through my prayer life on my knees, I now see, being also an MD and scientist, through our science. This unites heart and head. We're going to do that here. We're going to do a bit of basic science. We're going to do a bit of how science translates into basic, you might say, spiritual practice, and then look at its translation into service settings. But today's show happened to focus on one piece of a deep transcendent relationship, which is very common in Judeo-Christian traditions, which is prayer. I turn to God for guidance, and I get an answer, like young Maddie, right? I find myself talking to God, a dialogue, a living dialogue where an answer and guidance comes. The transcendent relationship is experienced in many traditions on earth, oftentimes in the first person. I feel a sense of oneness with the universe. I feel that I am part of existence along with all living beings, a sense of spirit in and through all of us, a oneness.
And the transcendent relationship is also echoed in our rich indigenous traditions, where I find spirit through crow, through wind and sun, through life itself. Right. So whether it's in the first person, the oneness, the second person, a dialogue with your higher power, or the third person through living beings, including fellow people, the transcendent relationship is alive and well for most people on Earth, and turns out to be the hub of many people's understanding of the nature of life itself, the fabric of reality. As you know, there is a great deal of emphasis on positive psychology these days, grit, optimism, curiosity. Just this week, together with my fantastic doctoral student, who's waving, Kelly Cobb, we were invited to Chicago to speak for 200 independent school heads who already, in their heart, like the priest, like the people at Covenant House, sensed the place of spirituality in their secular institutions, and who jumped right in to grab hold of this with great comfort and ease and relief that there was in fact a science to establish spirituality as central to child and adolescent development. And what they found to be most helpful of all was that when we look at these fabulous positive psychology traits for the moment from here over, we see that the very same child, the blue child, who's high in gratitude is high as compared to all other kids in life optimism, is high as compared to all other kids in grit, that all these nice positive psychology traits actually go together. And so it's very easy in a school setting or community setting or at the park to say that's a great kid. That's the blue kid, who's full of grit, full of optimism, full of meaning, full of purpose. And that this is a perfectly fine kid. But this soul on Earth has a really rough ride. Right, and this is who many of us are here and work each day to support along with all else. Right? So as we look at this pattern of all these nice positive psychology traits, grip, optimism, meaning going hand in hand, we actually see, upon looking through the science of spirituality, that for three out of these four lines, which is to say for 85% of kids, all of these positive psychology traits, grit, optimism, actually emanate from a core spiritual hub. They actually are associated most foundationally with a sense of a transcendent relationship and a sense that through that transcendent relationship, I live, says the child, in a sacred world. And so my meeting you now and you responding to what I'd asked God in my prayer last night, and my giving myself to a bigger purpose than to win for myself, maybe to win for the greater good, or maybe not to win at all, to serve the greater good. All of that emanates from a spiritual hub for the blue line, the green line, and the red line, which is 85% of kids. Put in other words, spirituality and positive psychology go hand in hand. And the more spiritually connected a child is, the more grit, optimism, and meaning they have. And if I do not feel spiritually connected, I have less grit, optimism, meaning, and purpose. It plays both ways. 15% of kids show a secondary path to positive assets. They are virtuous humanists. 15% of kids. And they are so welcome at the table, and it is a very valid path there, but it is a minority path into virtues of strengths and assets. So as educators, teachers, healers, we need to know that there are kids who have very strong personal assets as secular humanists, and there are about four-fifths of kids who derive their strengths through their spiritual connection. Okay. The lines you see are derived through a statistical process called latent class analysis, where you look over thousands of kids to see organic clusters. That's how we got those lines. Okay, what does the science say? Please.
Could you give us your working definition of spirituality?
Thank you. Wonderful. I appreciate that. Spirituality has many, 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 many definitions. However, the piece that I focus on here is that dimension of spirituality which in the medical sciences has been shown to be most robustly associated with health and thriving and to have a heritable component. So of all the many dimensions and forms of spirituality, our discussion and the focus of this book, which sums all this up, is the effects and the developmental path of a transcendent relationship.
a two-way living relationship with your higher power. So there's all sorts of other forms and dimensions of spirituality, but that is the core of the sciences when it comes to what we're endowed with by heredity and what is the root of health and thriving. There can be other correlates, there can be other ways to get there, but that's where the action is in the science. The transcendent relationship. In 1997 was first studied in a Judeo-Christian sample about 2,000 twins by Ken Kenmar. And what he found was that about 30% of our tendency to connect with our higher power, again, his sample is Judeo-Christian, but subsequent research has extended it to Eastern traditions and indigenous traditions. About 30% is due to heritability. We are born spiritual. This is very remarkable if we think about adolescence. Vroom. In adolescence, there's a surge of heritability, a 50% increase in the heritable. From the inside out, the adolescent starts seeking meaning and purpose at the cognitive level, but also with the back of the brain in a felt hunger, oftentimes an agitation, an exhilaration or ecstasy in the oneness, in the transcendence. And it's in that period of time that if spirituality in the transcendent relationship is supported, many studies have shown it to be robustly protective against the most prevalent forms of suffering. Depression, we know in this room, substance use and abuse, anxiety, risk. And the magnitude of that association is so great that it looks in many cases that we're looking at a diverted path of spiritual development or two sides of one coin. So here's the heads from the Today Show. Everywhere that you, this is a significance map, an aggregate of many heads, okay? Structural MRI. Everywhere that you see red, there's a thicker cortex in people with a sustained personal spirituality. These are very broad and pervasive regions of the brain. Normally an article has a little speck. These are very broad and pervasive regions of the brain, the occipital and parietal regions and the precuneus. Perception, emotion, and self-reflection. A thick cortex is processing power. So what is perhaps most striking is that in these very specific regions to show thickening in people with a sustained personal spirituality, we see a thinner cortex in people with recurrent depression and people at strong family risk for depression. A second layer of evidence to suggest that spirituality and depression may be two sides of one coin. When is this most relevant? In adolescence, the time of individuation. We are now repeating this, not with a structural MRI study, but with a functional MRI study, watching the brain's use in motion. And what we're finding is when we invite adolescents and young adults into our lab, we say, come in, relax, tell us two stories. Story one, we'd like you to tell us about a stressful situation. And story two, we'd like you to tell us about your transcendent relationship, the dimension of spirituality that we're focusing on right now. The first story is very stressful. It's oftentimes about accomplishment. It's very rarely about danger, it's about striving. And in the stressful story, what we see is the very same regions of the brain to light up as are found in addictions, right? The striatum and insula, craving centers. Stress comes from craving. And we know that our ancient wisdom traditions, our spiritual traditions, have a lot to say about craving and attachment and release of that as a source of stress and suffering. The insulin is trying and the craving centers light up. And then moments later, we say to our fabulous participants who've given us their afternoon, thank you. Tell me now about your relationship with your higher power or your transcendent relationship. And suddenly, this striatum and insula stop lighting up. No more blood's pumping through there. There's a release of craving. And we see these same regions functionally light up, the cortex of the occipital and parietal lobe. So they are now engaged in spiritual perception. And at 18, 19, 20, in a functional study, we see that to be part of their spiritual connection to their higher power. At
40, we see there to be structural change. Now here's the kicker. In these late adolescents and early adults who come in to tell us their two stories, the ones who really rev up, have the most intense spiritual transcendent experience, who really light up in the occipital cortex, are more depressed. Because the booting up of the surge, that surge, the 50% increase in the heritable contribution in adolescence, boots up as a hunger for transcendence, moments of great spiritual connection, but it also boots up as a half-empty glass of spirituality. And that's a pretty painful place to be. If we really take that seriously, what is my point when I'm really not sure there is one? What is the point of it all when I'm really not sure there is one? That's a pretty bitter pill. And that is a prevalent pill. We have cultural nicknames for that, like sophomore slump, adolescent angst. But if we dignify that and view it through the lens of science as reflective of spiritual development, as important as physical development, cognitive development, and all other lines, and in fact, perhaps the central hub, then we see this very common prevalent moderate depression as perhaps a developmental depression that is in just about every classroom, in just about every high school, in just about every college dorm, and certainly in just about every treatment office. Adolescents with a moderate level of depression are as distressed by it. It does bother them. It is intrusive as adolescents with a major depression, as reflected by equal rates of treatment seeking. Developmental depression is something that we've started to publish on lately in our team. The flip side of that, the strengths and the assets. If I can walk through the dark road of developmental depression and through that form a strong spiritual connection, transcendent connection, if I can in fact seize the opportunity of developmental depression, which ideally is resolved in spiritual growth and individuation, I then, as a spiritual teen, have a different looking life. This is life with a spiritual hub. This is a life where my identity is based on my meaning and purpose, and my work is based on contribution and calling. And the spiritual self, the sacred self, is a whole different experience in the very same room, in the very same school, with the very same peers, than a performance-based self, where my identity is based upon my success, where I'm as good as my talents and gains, and where other people are there to please me or advance me or make me happy, which is quite different than other people are there to share a sacred road in life, to be encouraged, to be helped along. The spiritual self unfolds into an entirely different developmental path. And this is what our 200 school heads in Chicago could not wait to integrate into their own schools. Okay. So this book comes out in a month. It is a summation of the science translated into practice. It is based on 2 decades of our work. But for you right now, when you return on Monday, as people of service, as leaders and people of transformation, how do you use this body of work to support a child? How do you use this body of work to reconceptualize of what we're doing in our workspace? And here's where I'd like to share with you a translation of basic science to what I might call basic practice. Mindfulness as a gateway for spiritual growth. Now remember, we saw on the Today Show prayer and the red parts of the head, thickened cortex associated with prayer. It turns out that with 85% overlap, the same regions of the brain show thickness with experienced meditators. So whether it's in the transcendent relationship through prayer or the transcendent relationship through meditation, the neural correlates are the same, adding some evidence to the possibility of a universal spirituality, a psycho-spiritual, biologically based, right, integrative spiritual path that is universal, a universal spirituality. I'm going to invite up now Eleanor Cobb,
to share some of the mindfulness practices that she has shared with students and teachers for years, often in the Bay Area. And she's going to lead us through a few basic practices for your experience and also for your consideration of bringing into your places of work.
If everyone could put your notepads and books and everything on the ground for a minute. And put both your feet on the ground. And your hands on your legs. And I invite you to close your eyes or just gently gaze at the ground. Whatever feels most comfortable. And bring awareness to your feet. Notice your feet connecting with the floor. Maybe you notice your feet connecting with your shoes, that they are on the floor. See if you can feel energy coming from your feet, going into the ground. Noticing energy coming from the ground into the feet. And then bring awareness to your hands. Notice what they feel like resting on the legs. Maybe they feel light, maybe they feel heavy. Notice the temperature. Do they feel warm or cool? Notice any sensations of tingling or tension. And then open your eyes and look at your hands and wiggle your fingers, noticing the movement. And wiggle your toes, feeling the movement of the toes. And then you can open your eyes and come back, and that is a grounding exercise. It can be a quarter of that time, it can be, you know, way longer, and it's just about bringing awareness to our body and connection to our body. And it's a pretty common mindfulness practice. So there are a lot of ways to do mindfulness practice. Some are with your eyes closed and focusing on the breath and the body. And some can be very different, and as long as they're about awareness and presence in the moment. So, and as Lisa said, mindfulness is one of the ways into spirituality. There's a study that we did showing four groups, broke adolescents into four groups, 11 to 16 year olds. And the four groups looked at their spirituality, their mindfulness, their religious practice, and their personal self-discovery. And the first group was, there were three groups that were high on spirituality. The first group, which was the highest on spirituality, was both high in religious practice and high in mindfulness, suggesting that there's potentially an additive and augmenting effect if you have both religious practice and a mindfulness to have the highest spirituality. Another group that was high in spirituality was high in religious practice and low in mindfulness. And another group that was equally as high in spirituality was the opposite, high in mindfulness and low in religious practice. And then the group that was the lowest in spirituality was also low on mindfulness and low on religious practice and high on self-discovery. So potentially they're a group that are still looking for their inroads, their gateway into spirituality. So it suggests why we're integrating mindfulness as another potential inroad to spirituality for adolescents. So another quick practice that one can do to kind of tap into a mindful way of being is you all write to-do lists, I'm sure. Or you think about writing to-do lists. And so one practice is when you're writing a to-do list, if you write three things on your to-do list, write three things on a to-be list. that can be really broad. It could be to be friendly, to be patient, to be a good student, to be a sharing sibling. And it just activates a different sense of our awareness of ourselves that isn't as much an achievement and accomplishing mode. As students, you know, adolescents are always, when we talk about this, doing it with adolescents, you know, they're always encouraged to be succeeding in school and accomplishing. And so this is another way just to tap in and be mindful of the whole present of ourselves as a person that's not always about accomplishment. And then one last exercise that we'll do in mindfulness is about mindfulness and awareness of others and as a whole and attunement. So what we'll do here is we'll count as a group, and I'm going to say one, and someone else can sporadically decide to say two. And we'll go around the room, and people can jump in whenever they like. If two people say the same number at the same time, then we'll start back at one. So, one.
Two.
Three. One.
Two.
One.
Two.
Two.
Three. You keep going.
Four.
One.
Two.
Three.
Five.
Six. Seven.
Someone else start one?
One.
I'm going to pause us. We can keep going for a long time. And what will happen is, in any group, this is really typical, in any group, over time, you'll see more and more get to higher numbers. As we become aware and different people develop different patterns, and we become aware of each other's different patterns. It's actually often harder, too, in this kind of formation when no one's looking at each other. So it's a fun thing to do with a group, maybe when you're in a circle or something like that. So, and then
what's
one...
What's the meaning of it?
Oh, yeah. So the meaning of it is just to notice what other people's process is. And so it brings you very present into what's happening in the room. And what a lot of people find, a lot of people report feeling really anxious or like, oh my gosh, should I say a number? And that in itself is mindfulness. It shows that mindfulness isn't always about feeling relaxed. A lot of times when we take deep breaths, people are like, oh, that's so relaxing. That's so nice and calming. And mindfulness can be just as much about being aware of our anxiety or our inclinations to jump in or to be more reticent. So it's about, and it's about noticing other people's patterns and attunement and connection. So one more practice that we'll do is, if everyone could stand up. We are going to increase blood flow to our brain. So here we're going to do typical mindfulness breathing. People know as breathing in slowly and breathing out slowly. And this is another kind of breathing in which you do three short breaths in and then a big breath out. So it looks like this. Ready? I encourage you to use your hands on the out-breath. Okay. So, you can sit down. It's just activating your brain in a different way that's been shown to increase blood flow and actually decrease, or actually activate the parasympathetic nervous system, so it decreases your anxiety. So mindfulness comes in many forms, and it looks many ways, and it can be a very creative process of coming up with different things, and I'm sure many of you have really great practices, and they're all great inroads to spirituality. Thank you.
So mindfulness as a gateway to awareness, attention, presence, perception, right? And the greater our perception, our greater perception of all, including spiritual perception. So in the same way that an experienced monk tends to give off in meditation high amplitude alpha, the very same people who you saw represented through the MRI maps, who came to spirituality through prayer, also gave off high amplitude alpha, posterior alpha. Spiritual attunement, spiritual connection, spiritual awareness. The effect was even greater in people to have recovered through the road of depression through spirituality. Again, hearkening to developmental depression, a porthole of spiritual awakening. And the effect is particularly striking in that it also, alpha, is found in people to recover from depression through Prozac, SSRIs. To boot or force a process which organically can be found through spiritual growth and emergence. There's a recent article, it was all over the New York Times in the past 2 weeks, that there are many people on Prozac who aren't depressed, meaning they are not depressives on Prozac, they are without depression on Prozac, right? Is it possible that we have an epidemic of people trying to figure out how to form a spiritual connection? Okay, this is the thing about mindfulness. Our culture and our educational community have succeeded and bringing mindfulness to a vast range of spaces. Our society is now saturated in mindfulness. But the notion that mindfulness is a doorway to spiritual awakening is something where we are now leaning forward to discover as a professional community, a community of service and science and practice. Prayer, meditation, meditation, prayer. Awareness, connection, awareness to the other human beings in the room, perception, attunement, presence, the opening to all perception. The spiritually engaged brain, whether through prayer or meditation, vibrates at high amplitude alpha. Alpha has another name in another field. It's Schumann's constant, which is the wavelength of the Earth's crust. The spiritually engaged brain vibrates at the same wavelength as the Earth's crust. A sense of oneness measured through vibration. An existence of oneness measured through vibration. And so when Lila has a baby, her baby will say, "Mom, what a riot that grandma measured consciousness by its wavelength." Consciousness in and through the earth, consciousness in and through us, whatever your language might be, shares a wavelength. And for now, science can describe it. And we can envision what we're measuring. So Ellie very generously shared with you some practices of the translation of the basic science of spiritual connection. I'd like to share with you a mindfulness practice that includes in it an explicit guided spiritual visualization told not in any specific tradition, but rather in the universal language of life. Mindfulness as a gateway to spiritual awakening can be a midwife process. We don't need to wait patiently while someone discovers it or not for 20 years. We can offer, invite people an opportunity to explore their own spiritual path on their own terms. Foster and support what all the science says is the cornerstone of health and thriving, a direct connection. So will you join me? I invite you to try this. This was a guided spiritual visualization rooted in mindfulness that was taught to me by an outstanding psychologist who had worked with hundreds of court-referred boys. When the judge could not see a boy another time, three runs through the court, he would call Dr. Gary Weaver. When all else, treatment as usual, failed, Dr. Weaver would bring in the boys, and he would do this practice along with others akin and a nature expedition through the Utah desert. And boys who had been abused, boys who had been terribly abused, some of them were now perpetrators and not people's, not particularly favorites of people, so they got constant derision, would reconnect with their own transcendent relationship this way. And I've now done this with thousands of people in all settings, and I've never heard anyone say, what was that? There's usually a stillness, so I'm going to invite you to try this. I invite you to breathe 7 breaths and open up your inner space. Within your inner space, I invite you to set before you a table. And to your table, you may invite anyone, living or deceased, who truly has your best interest in mind. Anyone who truly has your best interest in mind, living or deceased. And with them assembled there, ask them if they love you. And now you may invite to your table your higher self, your eternal self, that of you that is much greater than what you've done or not done, your higher self, your eternal self. And ask you, and now you may invite your higher power, by whatever name or word you use, your higher power to the table. And ask your higher power, and I love you. And now with all of those people assembled there right now for you, ask them what they need to let you know right now. What do they need to let you know in your path right now? When you're ready, I invite you back, and we want to jot a note to yourself. Was anyone surprised by who showed up at the table? Anyone else have a grandma at your table? Yeah. Yeah, truly has your best interest in mind. Yeah. People often are surprised who shows up, and yet it makes sense and it feels right. And they hear what right now they need to know. Who shows up at your table may vary based on where you are in your path, based on what you need to know right now. This is your counsel, and it is always there for you. This is your inner counsel, and it is a transcendent relationship. Whether through your higher power, your higher self, the oneness, or the people who truly have your best interest in mind, other living beings. Transcendent relationship. Counsel is a resource for every one of us, but we have found it to be particularly valuable for children who don't have much on the outside. And we've done this with children at Covenant House, and they love it. And they wake up to the notion that they are inherently sacred beings. And if I, who've been through the unspeakable, am a sacred being, then the guy next door to me in my shelter is also a sacred being. And the whole terrain shifts. Great. So I want to thank you and invite you into a reflection
of where spiritual life exists already in your life and work, and where you see it emerging in your life and work. And thank you for contributing to the transformation, the very TC transformation of serving children, teens, and families. Thanks.
I was curious to know, how do you get a young child, say about age 4, especially now that he has a sibling, in a spiritual practice where the couple has different religious backgrounds?
Beautiful. Okay. Thank you. Oh, great. Do you mind actually?
No, sure.
Okay, so this is an extraordinary question. Thank you. This is the door with the sun behind it. Okay. There's a study conducted by Mazur and Banaji that shows that by the age of 6, a child thinks that his or her name for the higher power, creator, Allah, Hashem, the transcendent, is more real than that name by a family of another faith tradition down the way. And by the age of 6, not only does the child think that his or her family's name for transcendence is more real, that child's more likely to want to share their school lunch with someone who has the same name. So if we look around the world, it appears that to be spiritually multilingual is crucial, absolutely crucial, and that it needs to be part of our development and education starting very young. Universal spirituality, whether we're looking at MRIs or in a host of other studies, is a foundational capacity in our nature. It is in every single one of us, and yet it needs guidance and support to come to fruition in a way that both is a hub of thriving, but also a platform for connection with fellow people of all faith traditions. So how do we do that? What does multilingualism look like? How is it taught? Well, we're getting better at multiculturalism, right? What is spiritual multilingualism? Often in school, we learn that those folks celebrate this holiday, and we make pictures or icons that look like their holiday. And these folks over here, they celebrate a different holiday, and we respect that they do, and they make these icons and ceremonies. That's not multilingualism. Hopefully it's respectful, but it's not multilingual. Multilingual is when we can share a foundational experience of spirituality, a universal experience in our heart, and be able to express our own spiritual experience in 4 different faith traditions. So that I can speak of my transcendent relationship in the language of 4 different faith traditions. I can speak of the birth of spring in 4 different faith traditions. I can speak of redemption, salvation, family, transformation, birth, death, all in the language of 4 different faith traditions. Then I, as your 5-year-old, am spiritually multilingual, because in the register of my heart, I know what it feels like, and I can tell it in the language of 4 different families from 4 different traditions. That's teachable. It's absolutely teachable. And little multilingual children can tell you what a table is and come up with 4 names for that. They can come up with 4 names for the feelings, the spiritual feelings of transcendence. I'm so grateful you asked that question. And that's actually something in this book I talk about a lot, that oftentimes education goes silent on the spiritual presence in human history. The Civil Rights Movement was a spiritual event. Yes, it happened in the African-American church, but it's not only fair to speak of that sociologically. It was a spiritual event, right? Why are we silent on spirituality? Great. So it's because it is such a hot potato, it doesn't get talked about. And I think by hosting a language that's universal or multilingual and based on science, the discussion is taken out of strictly the realm of religion into a foundational human capacity of spirituality that every single person has and can be told in the language of religion, but also outside the language of religion. Sure. Well, the school heads this past week, they had conversations about how often in their classroom, one child would make a diminutive remark about another person's faith tradition. And it was tempting and anxiety-provoking to shut that down as a discipline moment. Right. But instead, what a number of school heads shared in this conversation was they leaned into that. And they asked the children, you know, do you really feel that about this person's faith? Do you really feel? And what they found was that actually no one had hate or acrimony. They had ignorance about each other's faith traditions. So each child came in, called home so that everyone was on board. Every child came in and shared of their own faith tradition. And people were interested because it was coming from Allison and Jimmy, their friends. And pretty soon, the children in the classroom were able to hear some thread of commonality. Oh, you do believe in God. Or, oh, you don't call it God, but you do believe that there's a way. There's a way. They were very quick to pick that up. But it was choice, and it was a choice to not step out of a very anxious moment, right, where a parent could have come storming, I mean, but to choose to educate into that moment. And I think that is timely as well as universal.
Are you saying it's a matter of linguistics when you say that? Because you are being respectful in that moment. Mm. But you're choosing to use language in a way that's finding a common ground between all whatever religion it is. So it's a matter of framing through linguistics.
And practices, like we just did meditation and prayer and, you know, solitude walk and, you know, yes, language, practice, relationship. Thanks. Yeah.
Just to piggyback on that, it seems that since you mentioned supporting our own spiritual
thanks. It seems like something that's been thwarting our efforts to create this multilingualism is how certain components of certain doctrines do kind of set the religions against one another and do seem to create some barriers between each other by claiming what certain truths are that are incompatible with claims from other religions and even some explicit doctrines that speak about other religions specifically as being inferior. So what I'm wondering while I'm hearing this conversation is if there's a way, or if you think that what we need to do in the 21st century is move past the religions that some people might call antiquated into a new modern spirituality that is not set up by the religions that are already set up in a way that are posed against one another.
I would say that from the view of education, right?
Mm-hmm.
From the view of education, I think there's a conversation to be had about a foundational human capacity, which is largely an untapped capacity in many settings, of natural spirituality and innate spirituality.
Right. What is that separated from religion?
Great. Thank you. So when we look at large samples of teens, we see that the natural spirituality, that sense of connection, correlates only 0.3 out of 1. With religion. Mm-hmm. So a teen does not perceive their spirituality as synonymous with their, perhaps a very religious teen, with their religious embrace of their natural spirituality. Their language and practice that holds and fosters and develops their natural spirituality is perceived as distinct from an inchoate sense of transcendence. That's a teenager, right?
Is that a trend that's growing more?
Okay, there's another interesting question. So amongst teens and emerging adults, 35% of young adults consider themselves to be spiritual but not
but
religious.
Not right.
Right. Now, here's the thing. Spiritual about without religion is a deeply authentic path for many people. What has not been helpful to them when they become parents is how to get it in their kid. Because the spiritual but not religious parent actually had some whiff of religion growing up that supported them and developed their natural spirituality. And now, take it or leave it, it did its developmental job. It gave them a language of spirituality, relationships based on spiritual values, practices of spiritual opening and awakening. So here I am, 28, my new baby at one point. And we say, how, if I were to be one of the 35% that's spiritual but not religious, how do I help him or her foster her natural spirituality? And that's where deliberate effort is in play. And that's another reason I wrote this book, because we can distill from, I don't get paid if you buy the book, by the way. I don't. we can
distill. Very spiritual of you.
Gracious.
Sorry.
So, but what can we distill from the science and from a universal look across traditions that is buttressing of spirituality if I am that one third that doesn't bring my child into a house of worship? And some of the things we can distill is that there needs to be a practice of some sort that mm-hmm. is spiritually opening. Yeah. Another thing we can distill is that relationships are not just interpersonal events. There's a thread of sacredness through relationships. And that is true of everyone who truly has your best interest in mind, and it is particularly true of family. And so that family is actually family plus spiritual presence equals a field of love. It is a sacred field of love. And that's based on science. When we see a kid who's, okay, here's a nice living example. I had a student here at TC among us who was, her father was a refusenik from the Soviet Union. He never breathed a word about spirituality, never breathed a word about religion for fear it could put them in jeopardy. Mm-hmm. She grew up, didn't hear one peep, one word about spirituality or religion or anything transcendent. And she came to our beautiful spirituality class and said, I've got to tell everyone this. I am deeply spiritual. I am so spiritual. She said, but we didn't talk about spirituality, not one word. And I know the reason is that my father, he loved me. He loved me so much. And when I feel the sense of God, it feels a lot like the way my father loved me. That deep human love, that unconditional, palpable human love is a sacred love. And then when we look at the data, spirituality protects against depression by 60 to 80%. If you just have a deep, deep loving parent, that gets you about halfway there towards the formation of spirituality in the next generation. Another language, another way I've heard this put is, my grandma, she adored me. My grandma, I came home every night, my mom was working, and I sat by my grandma. And for me, when I close my eyes and I think of my grandma, God and my grandma are all rolled up into one. It's the intergenerational transmission of spirit through our relationships as ambassadors, as spiritual ambassadors. One last question?
Yeah, just someone else. I have 95 questions, so I...
We'll do one last.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
TC
so
style.
From what you just said, does it seem like spirituality might be a way of filling a void that could be filled by more interpersonal means? And that's maybe an origin of it, or maybe that's another problem that we could be working to fix a different way of targeting the same problem. So that when somebody has a spiritual need, if there are two ways of going about that, one is increasing their spirituality, and one is just actually increasing their well-being, or their material well-being and
spiritually
and their love relationships.
Communities. Yeah. Spiritually infused loving communities.
Yeah, exactly.
That goes hand in hand, absolutely.
So they're two... I see.
Well, if we look at the data, what's oh so protective is the personal spiritual relationship. The way we get there is oftentimes through the support of a spiritual community.
I see.
Or this loving grandma, mm-hmm. right? And that community, for 16% of kids, right, is more important. For 16% of kids, that community is more important than the transcendent relationship.
Right.
The purple line.
Right.
Thanks.
Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes.
Basically, you're saying atheists also can be spiritual. And in fact, people who are of a religious tradition have an easier time because they have a place to go to, they have a place to hang their hat on. What do you do in a case, as I mentioned, where you don't want to muddy the waters with a place to hang your hat on? How do you start a spiritual practice with a young child who you don't want to take to the temple or you don't want to take to the synagogue, but you want to create?
Okay, that's a great question. So oftentimes there's many families that come together with multiple faith traditions. And the data suggests that giving them both is better than giving them none if you have an authentic experience of any thread in either, right? Now, for families that don't want to hear about either of them, and there's plenty of that, right? Plenty of that. Then I'll share with you a practice of a family. Every Sunday night, there's a family dinner, and they feel that both the mother and the father are not interested in a continuation of either of their faith traditions. Every Sunday night, there's a gratitude practice. And the gratitude, and I think this family is certainly agnostic, probably atheist, and there's a gratitude practice which is a tradition the family holds dear to their heart, and they start when someone's 18 months. So you put into the bowl that for which you're grateful. It could be a picture you draw, it could be something you write, it could be an object, right? But just right there, you've gone beyond the atomistic self and seen the world as abundant and giving and you as appreciative. So there's an example. And yes, I think that mindfulness is all over the place because we're spiritually hungry, and then the language to talk about spiritual perception can be a language that comes from the family. You know, every family can have their own language of transcendence. You know, I find here I was, today I saw in school that you were so kind to the new child. And then there I was picking you up, and I saw that the new child's whole family had come over to meet you. Isn't it interesting how what comes around goes around? Patterns of abundance, patterns of, some might say karma, but patterns of the universe. The axioms of the ineffable become effable. Yeah. Hi.
You are on my dissertation committee, and
yes.
So
nice to see you, Danny.
You are on my dissertation committee, and my dissertation looked at people's need to understand death and the notion of an afterlife. And I was wondering, because it was looking at people who might not or might have some religious or spiritual background, but they're looking at popular culture and maybe internet communities as ways of gaining their own kind of belief that's a little bit more personal and understanding, not as accepted necessarily, but because a lot of the people that I saw in the internet discussion groups were very careful to hide their identity because they were afraid to reveal what they really believed in.
I think we're here where we can have open spiritual discussions. I think it's not an aspiration. I think we're here. When the Today Show has Al Roker talking about his spiritual life, we're here. And so, hey, like cutting edge TC vans, let's roar. You know, where do you see this going in your own work and in your own life? It's an incredibly important point that the spiritual journey is a shared journey, and that we can be, in our classes at TC, extraordinarily interested and respectful of each other's spiritual path. We, every semester, within our spirituality, mind-body concentration of the master's program, have classes in which people talk about their spiritual path. And people come from all over the world to do the summer intensive because they have been looking for a spiritually based graduate program for 10 or 12 years and finally found it. There's a hunger and a will to have this discussion and to work from this platform. And it's in the hands of the innovators to build out this for our society. Thank you. Thank you.